Morning and welcome as always on our sunrise safari. My name is Jamie, and for his final drive before he goes on holiday, just to clarify, not his final drive, just his final drive before he goes on a very well-deserved break, is Brian Joubert, and of course the thumb along for the ride. The thumb, of course, goes on holiday whenever Brian goes on holiday. They have a vacation planned as of tomorrow. No, this afternoon. As of this afternoon, after this drive. But yes, welcome on your live safari experience. I better keep my voice down because we're right next to the lodge. We are coming to you live from Juma, Arethusa, and Cheetah Plains Game Reserves in the Sabi Sand in the Greater Kruger National Park area of South Africa. And not only are we live, but we are also interactive, which means send through your questions on hashtag SafariLive on Twitter, or you can email them through on questions@wildearth.tv. And please do send us through your comments, your questions. We do love to hear from you. It's like having you on the back of the game drive with us. Right, with that sort of stuff out of the way, we do have the lovely Kirsty McLennan-Smith in final control with Lou. And Kirsty is also going on holiday, by the way, after this drive. In fact, they're all deserting us. James has left. James's car wouldn't start this morning, by the way. It was relatively hilarious. And Kirsty and Brian all disappearing. And then rejoining us in 2 weeks' time. Right, those of you who send through the updates about the lions calling, I've just picked up his tracks and I'm listening to the Game Drive channel, and apparently the lions are still calling up in Buffleshoek, but at least one male has walked through since his tracks wander across quarantine. So yours is telling me that from his camp he can hear the lions calling, but there must be others around, and I think that male might still be in this vicinity. And so I haven't picked up any sign of him, and I just want to chat to Brent because I know he headed in the direction of where those tracks were heading, and they haven't popped out here. Now bear with me one moment while I grab the Game Drive channel. Brent for Jamie. Did you pick up any tracks along main access? Copy. Brent says no, he didn't pick up any tracks. So, our lion could well be somewhere around here. I heard him as well, by the way, from the comfort and warmth of my bed. I heard the lions roaring away. Oof, and my fingers are very, very chilly. It's a chilly 9 degrees this morning, apparently, so 49 degrees Fahrenheit. Another coldish morning in midwinter in the African bush. So while Brian and myself search for this male lion, let's go over to Brent so he can say good morning.
It is the coldest morning of the year so far. It is a bitterly cold 9 degrees Celsius. Last year, the coldest day was 4. I'm hoping it doesn't go that low, but by the way, I'm Brent and I don't like the cold. And I have Dangerous Dave the Dish on camera with me today. We've actually been working on a song for Dangerous Dave to the Gummy Bears theme tune, but it is a work in progress. And I'm going to have to wait till Brian and James come back on leave because my singing voice is not something I want to make you guys endure. So we're checking the western edge of Juma at the moment. I'm throwing a bit of caution to the wind, and I'm hoping shadow might be about. So we're going to keep checking down here. It, as you can see, it's very cold. So 9 degrees, which I think is 47 Fahrenheit. It is our coldest morning of the year so far. And, oh, wait. The Impala alarm calling. Sounds like just to the east of Impala Plains. So we're going to go have a look. You can hear the snorting. Sorry, the Game Drive was very, very loud there. So it sounds like just to the east or northeast of Impala Plains, so we're going to head straight there. And when I say there's Impala alarm calling, It means they were snorting at possibly a predator. So going, and what is approaching us is not a predator, it is a car. And someone is up early and heading out. I'll wave and be friendly. Hi. Bye. They're not very friendly. I thought we were going to have a chat. Obviously, they don't want to chat with me this morning. But let's go check what those impala were alarming at. Okay. So we're about to approach impala plains. The alarm call sounded like they were on the next set of open areas, so slightly further to the northeast. Okay, let's have a look. And remember, apart from being live and frozen in the African bush, we're also interactive. So you can ask Jamie or I questions. And you can do that by sending us an email, questions@wildearth.tv, or you can use the hashtag SafariLive on Twitter. Now, I'm actually quite impressed that I'm even speaking to you in this bitterly cold weather. I remember when I used to work as a game ranger in the lodges to the south, for the first half an hour of drive, this is what you would get as one of my guests. But fortunately, I've matured and now I can speak in the cold, although my nose does get a little red. Not as quite as red as the dishy dangerous Dave, who is not covering his face. He's trying to be quite hardcore, but as they say, it's tough being tough. I'd rather be warm. Okay, I'm just going to switch off again. There's an alarm call sounded like they were this area. But while we sit and listen and not move in the bitterly cold morning, Jamie has got the fluffiest of fluffy antelopes to show you.
Well, Brent, sit still. Brian and myself have been moving right up into the point that we have come across the, well, really stunning example of a waterbuck bull. He is absolutely gorgeous. Giving us, oh no, so that's definitely your best side, boy. Oh, let's see the other side. Yes. They're very handsome. This is a very fluffy waterbuck. And as the name suggests, it is an antelope that does enjoy spending time in the rivers and river systems around the area. Unfortunately for them at the moment, there is no water pretty much anywhere except for one dam up in the corner of Juma. A couple of pumped pans, and that's about it. Well, he's not alone, actually. There is also one waterbuck off to the left, and he's actually even larger than the waterbuck that we started with. He is absolutely enormous. There's impressive backward curving horns. Look at him. Isn't he such a handsome specimen? Blinking lazily in the sort of first rays of the sun and are thinking about poking through and enjoying some time ruminating. Look at those horns, the ridges running along them. You can see where he's rubbed away the colours of the darkness of the keratin sheath. So see on the ridges there? That's come from thrashing his horns against either bushes or against other waterbuck. He's managed to clean away the dirt on the outside of the keratin ridges. I'm giggling because we have a wildebeest friend. He's put himself in a really awkward position. It's not just the waterbuck, but at the moment he's snorting at us. It's hilarious. He's watching us. He's walked all the way across quarantine clearings. He's now hidden himself behind a termite mound in the beautiful rising sun. Yes? What are you trying to tell me, boy? I really do like wildebeest. But they are... we wouldn't call them the Einsteins of the animal kingdom. They are terribly impressive looking, built for speed and strength and stamina, not necessarily so much for brain power, although he's clearly decided that the termite mound between us and him is a... I'm laughing because he saw us ages ago, and he's decided to walk all the way behind the termite mound, and now he's going to stop and gently snort at us. Or perhaps I'm mistaken, perhaps it's not at us at all. Perhaps he's trying to have a conversation with his friends, the waterbuck, and we just happen to have intruded. Oh, that's beautiful. Oh, that's awesome, Brian. That is so beautiful. Isn't that absolutely stunning? What a way to start a morning safari. And if you're listening really carefully, you'll also hear the sounds of the wood hoopoes cackling in the trees. Really, truly spectacular morning cacophony. Here goes our starlings. Awesome, Brian. A murmuration of starlings, isn't it? Collective noun for a group of starlings. I think it's a murmuration. Might be wrong. Beautiful. Time to move on to a much more action-packed scene with Brent.
So we found the impala that was snorting, and it looks like it was these young boys practicing for next year's rut. So snorting and headbutting, and now of course they decide to do it behind the only gwari bush. There we go, there they are. So unfortunately no predator, just teenage boys being full of testosterone, trying to show off. There we go, and looks like they might. No? Actually, we're having quite a serious little duel a bit earlier. And these boys, all of them are about 2 years old. So at about three will be their first year starting to properly participate in the rut and trying to get themselves some girlfriends. At the moment, they're still a bit young. So they're getting as much dueling practice as possible. Now, the Impalas, as I like to call them, of course that's not their real name, they are Impalas, I-M-P-A-L-A, but I definitely prefer the word Impalala. They just look like Impalas. What do you think, Dave?
I agree.
As Dave agrees, we shall now refer to them as Impalas till infinity and beyond. Now, they are incredibly, incredibly adaptable animals. So one of the few antelopes, oh there we go, that is both a grazer and a browser, so they're able to take advantage of multiple food sources, and that's why they're so successful. Now they have been in current shape and form for 1.6 million years unchanged. So if you pick up a fossil of an impala from 1.6 million years ago, it is exactly the same as the bones you would find of one of these impala. Dave, is it missed on our lens? I think we missed it up.
Yeah, that was over the camera.
Unfortunately, I think we've got a little bit of a camera issue. Our focus ring is slipping and getting stuck, so we might need to fix it quickly. As soon as we zoom in, it seems to be getting stuck. So what we do is we're going to jump across to Jamie while Dangerous Dave fixes the focus ring. So we'll be back shortly.
Oh, dearie me. And the seems as though problems happening with Dave's camera this morning. Dave, of course, being the talented cameraman that he is and the one that we are definitely not objectifying in any way, shape or form. We'll fix it in no time at all. Right, onwards, let us find, actually, you know what, before we go look for this lion, since we are here on Gallagher Shortcut, we might as well poke our nose in at the hyena den. Not optimistic, it's just been so quiet over the last few days in terms of hyena activity, but there are tracks up and down this road. One set of tracks, one hyena. Hold on. What have you guys seen? Or are you just looking into the sun? There's a couple of Inyala off to my left who are looking intently off to the right. Can you sort of see them there, Brian? I don't think that's as good as it's going to get. Hello. Good morning. We're definitely having an antelope-filled morning. And these two look very pretty in this morning sunlight. And I don't think they're looking at me. But I don't know if they're just listening to alarm calls elsewhere. Did hear some zebra yipping off in the distance. Or perhaps they just picked up on some movement that they want to identify. What's up, ladies? Whenever you have a group of antelope, or more than one antelope, and they're focused in one direction, it's always a good idea to go and have a look and just see or try and get an idea of where it is they're looking. Just because they all might be paying attention. You're not a Nyala. I thought you were a Nyala. You're a kudu. A very tiny, very fluffy, very lonely baby kudu. Shame, little one. That's down by one. Cute. Shame, I wonder where Mom is. Oh, Brent, I don't know where his tracks have crossed out. I think he's probably crossed towards Gallagher Pan. I'm going to check Gallagher Shortcut and then make my way east from there. I don't know if you want to check along Zoe's. Brent, wondering where he should go and check. That was a surprise. I really thought that was a little Nyala. Shame, little baby. Where's your mom? Not the first time. We often see baby kudu on their own. They very frequently get separated from their mothers. But that can occasionally be a sign that there was some predator hunting last night. Whether it could even be wild dogs that separated them. Let's go forward a little bit. Brent and I had this really heart-rending situation when we were in Kruger. And a little kudu had obviously been separated from mom and had tried to actually, it was so young that instinct to just make its way towards any kind of movement or life meant that it came and tried to suckle from my fingers. It walked right up behind me, it crept up behind me and started sucking on my fingers. It was so sad. The little thing was bleating. But when we went to try and get help for it, it disappeared into the bush, into the Kruger National Park. I don't know where this little one's mum is. Now, in this case, we've got either a baby or a female Nyala. Baby kudu, female Nyala. Both of which are species, and the impala, actually, that Brent had. Both of which are species that have, only the males have horns. And good morning to Norman. Oh, shame, this little thing looks so fluffy and cold. Good morning to Norman and welcome on the Sunrise Safari. The answer is no, there are no antelope here that have antlers that shed. I'm sure you know that is one of the primary differences between an antler and a horn, is the antler's ability to shed, and that of course is because it is made of solidified blood vessels rather than being made of solid bone, as is the case in the horns of all of our antelope. In some cases, with our wildebeest, for example, the female have horns as well, and in other species, things like nyalo, kudu, waterbuck, only the males have horns. Well, good luck, little kudu. Shame watching it disappear off. Might be more sensible to stay with the nyala for now. Find some company of its cousin. And Shamson, if this little one has been orphaned and it happened to come upon another mother, you wanted to know if kudu babies will ever, if kudu females will ever rear young that have been orphaned. Depends on the age at which they've been orphaned. I've never heard of kudu allocycling, each other's offspring, but just because I've never heard of it doesn't mean it doesn't happen. Just because it's never been recorded doesn't mean it doesn't happen, because of course it's very difficult for us to know exactly which kudu female is the mother of which calf, unless you see it at birth, at the moment of birth. But little antelope calves wean very quickly. You're talking about a couple of months and they are completely finished with their suckling experience. They're completely weaned. So at that point, if a little one is orphaned, even a little orphaned kudu, it will be allowed to sort of trail a group of kudu and stick with them and utilize this extra safety in numbers. So in that way, yes, it's not really raising the baby, but it is helping to look after it, sort of, in a way. Okay. Let's carry on, I think. Go and see what we can find at the Gallagher shortcut then. Okay. I hope that little kudu's okay. I don't see, usually when you see a baby kudu, if you look closely, you'll see other kudu around and about. But I don't see any sign of them. And another good morning to Joey in Australia. And Joey, I suppose you guys also going, or are in the middle of your winter, so it must be, I don't know which part of Australia you're from, it must be relatively chilly there too. Joey, in terms of the reaction of antelope to venomous snakes, things like mambas and cobras, it's very, very seldom that they get bitten, but it does happen. And sometimes you will find an unexplained dead animal, and that will often be as a result, particularly with babies, because they're inexperienced and they don't know how to react. They often get bitten by things like mambas or cobras. The answer is they run away. So they might freeze for a moment, and that of course is what ideally you should do with a snake, because staying as still as possible if you're up close is the best way of making sure that the snake doesn't feel threatened and therefore doesn't react by biting. But for the most part, they will just turn and move away. That being said, encounters are relatively limited. The snakes are so good at picking up the movements of the vibrations of the animals and moving out of their way almost immediately, which is why you hardly ever hear of accidental bites with human beings. Things like mambas and cobras, they're not innately aggressive. They will almost invariably move out of a person's way if they happen to stumble across them. 90% of snake bites in this country are obtained by people trying to handle the snakes. Catch them, catch them, handle them in any way, move them. That's where snake bites actually occur, and that's why you should never try and catch a snake unless you have the necessary experience and qualifications. Okay, let's just do a quick check. I don't think she's still here, but let's try. So while we creak and groan our way towards the hyena den, let's go over to Brent while we have a look here.
Oh dear, they've just flown off, but they are in this early morning light, absolutely gorgeous, brown-headed parrots. So I'm going to try actually catch up with them. I think they landed in that marula tree. Ah, darn it. There's tracks of a big herd of buffalo, but they just skirt through the northeastern corner of Juma and on to the north. OK, Okay, Dave, did you see where those parrots landed? I think they landed in that apple leaf beyond the marulas. I think Aubrey's also spotted the parrots. I can hear them squawking. Oh, they flew. And they just moved into that marula tree. Okay, I'm gonna move for you, Dave. Now, the parrots are gonna have to move massive distance at the moment. Of course, being parrots, they like eating fruit, and there's not too much fruit about. They do eat leaves as well, especially in times of drought like this and during the dry season. Can you hear them squawking? Oh, don't fly! One flew. I can still hear the other squawking. Oh, there we go. It's also flown. Oh, it's coming back. No, it's going around. It's not coming back. Oh yeah, well, we tried. So just a quick update on Queen Karula. I just got some information now. So apparently she very nearly lost a cub yesterday. So after she crossed to the south, where she had an impala kill, the cub was feeding on the kill and the hyenas rushed in and the cub just managed to get into the tree, and the hyenas did steal the kill. So there's a possibility she might have moved back towards us. So Aubrey and myself are actually heading in that area to try to see if we can find any sign of Queen Karula. Now, I know lots of you were very worried after those hyenas arrived yesterday. And the scary thing is that probably happens 5-6 times a week when we're not there. And it is what hyenas do. If they pick up fresh leopard tracks, they'll track them by scent. And those cubs have probably seen more hyenas than we have in the last week. And near misses like they had yesterday is a very good learning curve for them. It makes them that much more aware and that much quicker to get out of danger. I love the smell of the bush in winter. It's a dust. And it's fresh. It's a fresh smell this morning. You can smell sort of like dry leaves and dust. A bit of elephant dung, a bit of hippo dung. A bit of buffalo now. Now, Boyd. Hi, Boyd. Boyd's in North Carolina. And Boyd would like to know, would predators hunt more or less in winter? They hunt about the same amount of time, except they just hunted at more convenient times for us in the winter because of the cool temperatures during the day and it gets colder earlier. They're more likely to hunt for a bit longer in the mornings and a bit earlier in the evenings. So I wouldn't say they hunt more or less, they just hunt at more convenient times for us. In the summer, a lot of the hunting probably takes place about 10 p.m. till about 1 a.m., whereas in the winter it takes place from about 5 p.m. to about 8 p.m. So it's just because it's cool, it gets colder quickly, can you guys hear that? It's not a call you hear too often, it's actually a tawny eagle. Let's just see if we can find it. If it's calling like that, it's probably sitting high up in a tree. And I know we had that incredible sighting with Jamie yesterday of that tawny eagle drinking at 3-in-a-row pan on Cheetah Plains. So Dave, I want you to check the tops of the trees. It's probably going to be in a dead tree, where it's got some nice open wing space to move in. Guess it's going to be around here. Now that was a call that was coming from a stationary position. It wasn't a call that they make while they're flying. It could be down in the river system where we can't see, but oh, it was beautiful. We can hear it again. Can you hear that, Dad? And we can hear another bird off to the right making lots of noise. That's a little canary. Not nearly as interesting as a massive eagle. So I think we're going to keep looking for the eagle. The canaries, of course the canaries are beautiful, but I really want to see if we can find that eagle calling for you. So they throw their head back. It is just a magnificent sight. Oh, that's not an eagle, but it is a beautiful little bird, an emerald spotted wood dove. Shivambalan. Now, of course, that is not Shivambalan the leopard, but that is the Shangaan name for an emerald spotted wood dove. Now, I'm hoping it just moves a little bit so those little dark patches that are in the shade at the moment will shine in the light. And those are these most incredible little emerald spots. See how puffed up he is from the cold, trapping air between his feathers and his body. Oh, we can hear the eagle calling again. Oh, off he goes. Isn't that lovely? Could be in the jackalberry trees around Spaghetti Junction. We're going to go closer there. So where Dave is showing you those big trees in the distance, that's where it sounds like that eagle. Oh no, I can see it! It's very far away though. Through that gap, to the right. There's two calling. I think I got the gap, you don't, Dave. Let me just go there. I think it looks like a martial eagle. Now, I do apologize for my incorrect eagle call, but that looks like a martial. Now, there's another one calling closer to us. Just, oh, I just pulled my ears out, but I'll put them back in. I'm just trying to see if I can spot it. Sounds like it's down in the drainage system. Now, martial eagles are not an eagle we get to see often, and they are the biggest eagle in the whole of Southern Africa. They've got a wingspan of over 2 meters. I'm not sure what that is in feet, I apologize immensely, but it's a lot of feet. I'm 6'3", so their wingspan is bigger than me by... Oh, and there's some elephants making a noise over there. So let's head in that area. We've got a martial eagle calling, and we've got elephants trumpeting. Oh, let me get my blanket ready. Sorry, it is bitterly cold. There's my blankie, and my pink hot water bottle. And that Jamie made for me this morning. So nice and warm. Okay, let's continue. Now we're going to try and get to that martial eagle because we know where it is. We can't see the other one. And then we're going to loop our way back there because there's elephants trumpeting as well. Now, see, this is the wonderful thing about being on safari every day. I consider myself an above average birder. Now, and a lot of the predatory birds, a lot of their calls sound quite similar. And there's slight nuances now that I've learned because I haven't seen a martial eagle in so long. And you forget stuff, and this is incredible about nature. It reminds you. Obviously, I needed to brush up on my martial eagle calls. So the martial eagles are calling profusely this morning. And he's got the wonderful little on the end. It probably doesn't sound quite like that, but that's how I remember it. I must say, I do love the dry season. Although I complain constantly about being cold, that hot water bottle, a hot water bottle, some mitts, a scarf, and you're A to go. And for me, the mornings at this time of the year are just my favorite. You got not a cloud in the sky. Hi, Red. Red says, I understand that we don't need air conditioners because it's open, but couldn't we get heaters? Oh, well, see, with a car of this age, I'm sure, I'm trying to see, I don't even think it came with a heater originally. So this, I'm in Wendy. Wendy is 1996. So what is that? 96? 2006, it's 10 years. 2006, yeah, 20 years old. So if we have a look, and I'm going to get Dave to show you what's down here. So this doesn't even, it didn't come with an air conditioner or a heater. So what you have here, you see this little button to the right of the steering wheel. Can you see that there, Dave? Let me just move through here. Let me turn the car a bit so you can see it. So, can you see it now? Oh dear, it's hiding behind the steering wheel. But see, there we go. There's this little thing here. And if we look, can you zoom in here? So this is the original Land Rover version of an air conditioner. Vent. Basically, all it does, when I pull it, it opens up something on the front here, which we have closed, of course, due to all the equipment. So basically, it didn't have an aircon, didn't have a heater. You pull the vent thing, and it literally opens a little vent. And now you have air coming straight through your dashboard. So it's a very old car. So there's no such things as heaters and air conditioning. Wendy is 20 years old this year. I think, and now it's, how old does a car have to be vintage? I think it's 25 years. If you guys know, I'm sure some of you know a lot more about cars than I do. And so if you know, how old does a car have to be classified as vintage? Let me know by sending me an email at questions@wildearth.tv or use the hashtag Safari Live on Twitter. So while we discuss, or Dave and I discuss, what is considered a vintage car, let's go to Jamie, who's probably following up on something far more interesting than vintage cars.
As we drive along on our almost vintage cars, we do have relatively fresh lion tracks going into this area. Sorry, I am really distracted right now because I'm trying to figure out exactly what is going on with our lovely Nkuhuma Pride and their little ones, because I can see cub tracks in the road and I can't even show them to you because they are so difficult to see. They're in a stony, rocky area. Let me just try going a bit further forward. All of the calling, I think they're in Buffles Hook. Most of the things that I can hear, most of the calls that I can hear are coming from the Buffles Hook side, so a property that is to the north of our boundary, unfortunately. So a place we can't go. I'm hoping perhaps there's a female with the bigger cubs somewhere here. I can't get a good example to show you, sorry. Let me try a little bit further ahead. They have been driven over as well, which also doesn't help. But there were definitely little cub tracks in the road here. Let's see if they go off this way. Haven't come through here. We would see it. Nope. Let's keep going. Let's keep looking. See if I can't find you a nice clear example of this. Dino, apparently the lion calls sounded odd last night, and you suggested almost like they were fighting over something, perhaps a kill. I've just heard on the Game Drive channel that the guys suspect that the lions have a kill somewhere on Buffles Hook. But you could be 100% right, and even if the lionesses or the male lions had killed something small, it could potentially have caused all of those strange sounds that you were hearing, and then they might have finished it off, because an impala or something similar between five lionesses and maybe a couple of males is not going to go very far. See, to me, these look like little lion cubs. Let's just go. Oh, sorry guys, I'm struggling to try and show you this, but they're in the road and they're a little bit clearer, so let's try. Gives me a chance to have a look as well. Can you sort of get those up there, Brian? I know the light's not fantastic yet, but I do want to just hop out and have a look. I'll show you now where I'm looking. They're all over the show. Sorry everybody, it's always a bit of a laborious process when I get out of the car because I have to remove the hot water bottle that is under my jacket. They're very difficult to see. Ooh, better just check that I'm not about to bump into an angry lioness. These almost look... Do you hear that, Brian? I think there's one just up here. You're growling at me. Okay, let me show you these tracks quickly. Just we'll keep an eye out, Brian. The tracks are here, going up this way. They look, at this point, almost like male leopard tracks, except they're not. They are most definitely not, and the reason I say that is because there's two sets of them. There's actually another one over here, moving up this way. I think this is lion cubs, but where's the adult? Such tricky soil to see this in. There should be adult tracks somewhere here, and there's not. Unless she's walking on the side here, in which case we'd never, ever see them, or somebody's driven over them. But these are the tracks here. Back track, and toes over here, 2, 3, 4 toes. Immediately those toes, the shape of those toes is wrong for a leopard. They are too pointed. There's something much more teardrop shaped about the tracks of a lion cub. I heard something there, let's go investigate. I don't want to delay too long. In case they're on the move. Let's go see what I heard. I might even have been getting a low rumble at me. Although, I don't think I'm close enough. Lions are incredibly kind in the sense that very often before they... Sorry, I've got to tuck myself back into my hot water bottle. Before they charge or get cross with you, they usually warn you with a gentle growl. And I think that's what I heard there. Definitely heard something. The tracks go off in here. I've just changed my mind about something. I don't think we're track... We're not tracking lions. I think we've got a mating leopard pair in here. So the toe shape, it's not lion cubs. That's why there's no adult. There's a mating leopard pair in here. And we're going to find them because we're going to find them by sound. This is awesome! Been a long time since we've had mating leopards. Let's go in here, onto the fire break, and we're going to go and sit and listen, because that's what I heard. That's what growled. It's not them growling at me, it's them growling at each other. Now, Safari Dean, totally distracted. No, the drought doesn't make it harder for ambush predators. Although you are right, there's less cover for them, there is a big log there. There's less cover for them. Their camouflage is incredible, and all they have to do is wait around water holes, and the animals have to come in that direction. And no matter how bad the drought gets, this sort of strychnos cover is going to hide them. Okay, let's sit. We're going to hear them again. We're going to hear them soon, I hope. Unless they're moving in this block, which is going to be a nightmare. Could it be Mvula and Shuluva? Or is it Tingana and another male? Oh, not another male. Sorry, definitely not Tingana and another male. I mean Tingana and another female. Come on, guys. Those of you who've experienced leopard mating, you know that it is a relatively regular affair, and it is done with great enthusiasm and plenty of noise. While we sit and wait for them to mate again, I'm actually going to take my earpiece out completely so I can listen with both ears. While we do that, let's go across to Brent for an update.
Hi. So we're on the southern edge of Juma. Aubrey's been checking from Shabam Road, and I've been checking okay. Oh, I just hear Jamie's had more audio of mating leopards. I just want to check this track here quickly. Looks like it could be a bit old. It's definitely Queen Karula, but I don't think it's fresh. Do you see where I'm looking, Dave? Right to the right. There. I'm just going to move off the road here quickly. And yes, no. The more I look at it, the less fresh it gets. Okay, Aubrey, who's just up the road there, has got tracks of Karula. He says it looks like it's from last night, heading towards us, and I don't have any tracks of it here. Let's hope she ducks in. So if I'm not looking back at camera, I do apologize. I am concentrating so we don't miss tracks. I heard a Franklin alarm call, but no, I think it was probably just a noisy starling. And there is the noisy starling as it flies past, and the next second noisy starling flying past. Oh, that one landed. A Birchall's starling. It always pays to use your ears out here in the bush. They will find you animals before your eyes do, very often. But no alarm calls, so we're going to keep going. Whoopsie. Aubrey's coming down towards us, and he's found those tracks. We're just going to go very slowly. Although I have the utmost confidence in William, Aubrey's tracker will spot sitting atop the bonnet there. We're just hoping she hasn't gone that way, and we're hoping she's gone this way. Here are tracks. Okay, so we can see the tracks quite clearly now. Okay, there we go. There she is, walking down the road, but I don't see where they go. They have been driven over, but this is a very busy road. So that is not unusual. I actually think these tracks are from yesterday morning, to be honest. I'm just going to chat to Aubrey quickly because I did see them yesterday morning. And I don't think these are from last night. So I'm just going to have a quick morning meeting with Aubrey. How's it, well? Hello, Orbs. These unkons are from yesterday. I had the same ones going east yesterday morning. Yeah, she crossed here, there, with the mampimpans yesterday. Ah, bye, enjoy, guys. Morning. Okay. So, unfortunately, we both agree that those tracks are not fresh, so it seems like Queen Karula is still to the south. I might get hold of Jamie, go give her a hand in that area. Let's just have a quick look, see if there's any fresh tracks. No. Oh! Doves playing chicken. They're going to land now. There you go, it's a Cape turtle dove. Now, they've got a very distinct call, the Cape turtle dove. Now, a lot of people think they say different things. So a lot of people say, they say Cape turtle. A lot of other people say, they say work harder. I personally think they say drink lager. But, of course, it's up to you to decide what the Cape turtle dove says. Hi, Natasha from Ontario. So Natasha, of course, knows a lot more about being cold than we do out here. Canada is not called the Great White North for nothing. And I think your summer's probably akin to our winter. Now, Natasha would like to know if there are any birds we only see in the winter months. No. So we see all the bird species that we see in winter, we'll see in summer. Sometimes it's harder to see them due to the thick foliage. Now, a little bit further to the west of us, closer to the mountains, you do get altitudinal migrants. Of course, we've got our intra-Africa and intra-continental migrants, like the European beater and the European... What was that? That was not there yesterday. I know, I drove this road a lot yesterday. I think it's the same mail line that Jamie was following, but he went to Buffalo's Hook. So we're talking about the intra-Africa and intercontinental migrants. So our intercontinental migrants, European bee-eaters, European rollers, steppe eagles, steppe buzzards. We can go on and on and on. There's lots of those. And then our intra-African migrants, a lot of our cuckoo species, flycatchers, paradise flycatcher, that move between Africa. And then altitudinal migrants, and that's a far less of a move. And my favorite of all favorite altitudinal migrants comes down from the forests in the Drakensberg, and it comes down to the foothills. So we're a bit too far. So in the forests around the foothills of the Drakensberg, you get the white-starred robin. Now, I think... Maybe... I must turn the volume up. One of my favorite calls. Now, at my parents' house, which is a lot closer to the mountains, we get white-starred robin in the riverine forest because they've moved down from the mountains as it gets really cold and snow and snowy and frosty. So during the winter months they actually move down, but right to the edge of the low veld to enjoy the warmer climes. And it's a really, really cool bird, and it's actually quite a rare bird. Not many people have actually seen white-starred robin. I've been quite lucky, I've seen a lot of them, but Also, you always find what you're looking for. So I'm always looking for them, so I tend to find them. And also knows to helps if you know where to look. So it seems like Queen Karula in the south. Well, thank you to Shamsung and Kyle, who say about vintage cars, it used to be 20 years. So the Wendela, the rust buckets, no, the rust buckets 20 next year. The Jigger is 21. Unfortunately, I think Jigger might be terminal. We'll find out later. It's still at the car doctor in Pretoria. But so the Wendela is 20 years old, and they say it used to be 20. It is now 30 years to be classified as vintage. Unfortunately, in Wendy's line of work, I'm willing to almost bet my whole left leg that Wendy will not survive to 30 years, especially if there's wild dogs around. But she's done well. It's not an easy job being driven by the likes of James Henry, because he can't see over the bonnet, so he keeps crashing into things and trying to blame me. Now, these are incredible little vehicles, but they do have a very tough life. And it's very seldom that vehicles get used as much as they do. I mean, think about it, 6 hours a day every day when they're not broken. Okay, we can hear that. Now, that is a little owl calling. Well, trying to find the owl is a different story. I mean, it is about 10 centimeters tall, so it's tiny. Now, of course, it could also be a fork-tailed drongo. Yes, it's a fork-tailed drongo. So they mimic the owls to beat them up. So they'll do the owl call to get an owl to pop itself open so they can beat it up. And where's the owl? I can hear him mimicking. I'll do it again now. But the drongo is around here somewhere. No, it's not answering. Oh, there's the owl. Okay, sorry, very quickly we're going to look at the little pearl-spotted owl. And you got it, Dave? Yep. There we go. And there's hyena calling. But Jamie has got the most exciting news for you, so let's go across to Jamie. Standing by.
Have the most exciting news for you. We are right about it being a mating leopard pair. They're just incredibly tricky to get to, so bear with me. They were mating right in front of us, but unfortunately they've moved now. Let us go and figure out which pair it may be. Oh, there they go. Oh, I think it's Impala. I really do. I think it's Impala. It's the first time I've ever seen Impala mating. Sorry, guys. Bear with me 1 second. Oh, this is a tricky block. I don't know which female it is, though. And it can't be Karula. It can't be Shadow. And it can't be Tunley. You good there, Brian? Oh, they are definitely going to make our lives relatively tricky. They're going to pop in, out in front of us. Let's just see if we can figure out who we've got here. Here we go. I'm inclined to say that's Impala. And his lady friend coming behind? I have no idea who that is. Let us go and catch up with our moving pair and see who we've got. Phew! Okay, tricky block. Everybody hold on, it might get a bit noisy. I was a little bit worried it was going to be Gijima and that we wouldn't be able to catch up with him, but it's not. It is definitely not, or else he wouldn't still be around. So we've got a relaxed leopard here. We've got two relaxed leopards. Oopsie. And one stalled vehicle. Okay, perfect. Thank you, boy. You legend, you. I don't think the female's too relaxed. So let's give them a little bit of extra space here. And I think, James Richard, that it is Mvula and Shaluva, but it would also be my first time seeing her, and I don't want to startle her or scare her. So let's just approach this nice and carefully, because she's moving off. He's staying, but she's moving. Let's just stop here. Let's just see where she is. I don't want to push any further in. Go ahead, Brent. There we go. I'm in the block just west of Gari Cutline. I'm not sure this Mufa's too relaxed. Oh, there she is. Oh, she's coming back. Copy that, sister, my one. She's going to come and mate with him. Who is this? Come on, girl, give us a view of your face. She has relaxed. She's a lot more relaxed than I thought. Awesome. This is not a leopard I know. It's Mvula, and this must be Shaluva. Who are you, girl? Guys, I'd love to hear from you. Oh, sweet. Doing the sort of very cutesy female thing. Who is this, everybody? Those of you who know the leopards out here, is this Shaluva? She looks a bit nervous. Okay, we're gonna really struggle through here. I'm gonna get hold of Brent. I'm gonna get him into the area to help us out. Oh, Brent, if you can make your way along Gari Cutline, I'm not sure of your position. If any other vehicle wants to approach, they are mobile now to the northeast. Copy that, Ephraim. I could lose them in this block. Very, very tricky. Obviously, this is Monkey Orange personified. I've still got a view of them, but we have to go around. So everybody hold on. Oh, how big is that stump? No, we can do it. Guys, I need to get around this particular patch. I need to concentrate on finding our leopards, which is terribly exciting. So while we do that, let's send you over to Brent, and I'll catch up with you shortly.
So exciting, I wonder what female it is. And remember, female leopards can move up to four territories over. So this could be a leopard we've never seen before. So I know they're going through a particularly difficult area. And so we're rushing to give Jamie a hand and to make sure we don't lose those leopards. And Everyone else is far away. Ooh, the car tried to run away from me, but we're on our way. Oh, no, that's not good. There's a clutch. The clutch seems to be sticking. Well, it's fine, we'll just go into low range. We don't need to use a clutch. Okay. Hold on. Sorry, I'm just feeling this. The car, the clutch got stuck there for a second. And that's why you heard the revs go, woo! Well, she might not be a vintage if you're officially vintage, but in my eyes, Wendy is always vintage. Good girl. Please don't break. Please. Now, of course, our vehicles. Okay, so I've just heard that we're quite sure the male is Mvula, but no one knows who the female is. Mvula, you old stud, you. I mean, he shouldn't be mating. Is he just trying to sneak in there? Hopefully, for Mvula's sake, Tingana doesn't hear them. Otherwise, he'll definitely come make his presence known. Okay, so while we make our way towards Jamie to give her a hand in that area, let's go back to her. She's found the leopards again.
You've got a Mvula. I know it's not the best view, but there's a reason that I'm sitting still for now. I think I'm very strongly believe that this female is Shuluva. She doesn't look like Tsukani. But what's happened is they've become separated in this monkey orange. She's not skittish, but she's not 100% relaxed with us. So we're just going to sit tight for now, and we'll wait for him to lure her back to him. She's not going to resist his attentions for long. But I do want to just hop on the Game Drive channel and let Ephraim know. Ephraim, when they do pop out, he's gone static for now. I don't know where she is. I've lost visual of her. She's not 100% relaxed. He's having a little bit of a clean. I think we can go forward a bit, just to get a view of his beautiful face. Yes, what a marvelous way of starting off a morning then with mating leopards. Definitely not where I expected the morning to go, but I'm thrilled nevertheless, and he's being very kind to us. He's lying down. So let's reposition once to get a view of him, and then we'll stop and we will wait. How's your view there, Brian? A bit further forward. Oh yeah, sorry. There we go. I see. Perfect. And hello to Shamsun as we look at the glorious leopard in front of us. Yes, leopards do have barbed penises. It's just that these two have been mating for a while. And that's why there's not the same level of aggression. But when leopards first start mating, they are actually angrier than lions when they do mate. This is what's known as induced ovulation. It requires regular mating and stimulation of the female. Hello, boy. And we still don't have an ID on the female. Look, he's actually got fresh blood on his shoulder. Probably where she's turned round and scratched him. Hello, boy. Where's your lady friend gone? There you go. You can see the matted injury. Now, for Mvula to be mating, we have an extraordinary tale to tell you about this particular male. He is a dispersal male at this point. There she is. Screenshots, everybody. Let's figure out which leopardess this is. Oh, girl. There we go. sound effects that accompany a leopard mating. There you go, James Richard. James Richard thinks it looks like Shaluva. I don't know what Shaluva looks like, to be 100% honest with you. It's definitely not Sakani, you are right. This leopardess is too old to be Sakani. And we've also got a view of the yellowed teeth of Mvula. Oh, this is so awesome, a new leopard. So exciting. Okay, let's keep up with him once again. I do need to get hold of Brent. He's been trying to come and help, but I can't because there's a conversation happening on the Game Drive channel. Okay, girl. All right. Go ahead, Brent. Brent, we're quite far up Gari Cutline. We're quite far north up Gari Cutline. I'm not even sure you'll have a signal here, but keep coming. I'll let you know when I've got your audio. We must be very close to the fire break. Sorry, guys. Just helping Brent get into the sighting. The reason we're putting two of us in here is just because we run the risk of losing these two marvelous leopards, and this is too exciting an opportunity to miss. To have Mvula, who was the dominant male in this area, mating once again with his lovely lady friend, his mysterious lovely lady friend, is just too marvelous for words. This is actually the first time I've ever seen Mvula mate. I arrived just at the point where Tingana became dominant in this area and actually started to push him out of his normal territory. And at his age, Mvula is reaching the point at which he will no longer have these opportunities. So to see something like this is absolutely marvelous. Mvula used to be essentially the king to Karula's queen. Now, who is this, everybody? I think Shaluva. Whoever she's certainly... Oh, look at that beautiful face, green eyes. She's certainly enthusiastic about him. Him less so, as always. Awesome. Thank you to Ellen Fowler, who says that it is Shaluva indeed. World, meet Shaluva. Shaluva, meet World, although she's more distracted by Mvula, who's showing her every enthusiasm that we've come to know and love of male leopards. Okay, if you insist. This is so us. Oh, they've definitely nearly reached the end. They've both got empty bellies, and she's not nearly as violent as she might normally be. Awesome, awesome. Such a stunning sight. It's nice to meet you, Shaluva. A different leopard to add to... What an incredible week I've had. Quarantine, Shaluva. To see Mvula mating again. Look at her nicked ears. Those are very, very easily identifiable. That right ear will always know her in future. And is Ingwer now mobile again towards Gari Cutline? Yay! What an awesome morning! Definitely a good way. Definitely a good send-off, eh, Brian? Yeah. The best. Thank you. The wonderful thing about mating leopards is when you find those tracks, when you find those fresh tracks, you know you're going to find them because you know they are going to make a noise. Brent, have you got my audio? Copy that. I can hear you, I think. I think it's you I can hear. Copy. Where those Franklin are calling, that's us. So, just helping Brent out in terms of our positioning. And helping him get into a good position to help us. That's affirmative. I think stand by there for now. I'll let you know if it gets too thick in here for me to follow them. They're flat for now. Yay! A new leopard. Is this the first time you've seen Shaluva, Brian? Second time. Okay. Hello, girl. She's definitely a first for me. Oh. Exhausted. As I said, I think this is the end of their mating period. Now, if this is your first time seeing mating leopards, first of all, I'm sure you're struck by the amount of noise. Secondly, the frequency of the mating. And you'll be surprised to hear that this probably has continued over the last 5 or so days, if not even longer. A leopard mating tends to be even more frequent than lion mating, particularly in the early mornings, like this morning, because it's nice and cool for them. And we've seen them with Tingana and Tundi, for example, or Tingana Karula mating every couple of minutes. And I really mean every couple of minutes, I mean every 2 minutes or so. And that is a process of induced ovulation. Oh, well, there we go. We've got an interesting aspect to our storyline. Now, this is something I didn't know, but Paige in Tennessee, Mvula is a potential father to Shaluva. So the plot thickens here a little bit, as it always does in the cat world, because they are not bound by our rules of morality, so to speak. It's not Paige's question, of course. Paige is just telling me that, which is something I didn't know. Look, we never know with leopard fathers until the paternity tests are done. Hopefully, I'm really hoping, this is the weirdest sentence I think that's come out of my mouth in a while, I'm really hoping that Shaluva decides to defecate, because then we can collect her scat and we can deliver it to Panthera to do DNA tests on, because of course you never know who a leopard's father is. But if Mvula is her potential father, let's say he is, the disadvantages, Paige, there aren't actually major disadvantages, not initially. So the cat lions, the lions, the leopards and so on, they can usually sort of, their genetic structure can usually withstand about 6 or so generations of inbreeding. It's not ideal. So it's interesting that Mvula has managed to stay as dominant as he has in this area. I didn't realize he had, because Shaluva, I don't know how old Shaluva is, but she doesn't look young. To me, she doesn't look Sakani's age, for example. So I'm impressed at Mvula's longevity, because usually inbreeding within leopards is prevented by the males. By the time their daughters are old enough to mate, the males have usually lost their tenure. Mvula is being very bad and bold and very brave to be where he is at the moment. He is right in Tingana Central Territory. But who knows what conversations and challenges have gone on while we've all been tucked up sleeping in our beds. Perhaps there's more to this than meets the eye. Well, we certainly can say that Mvula is not yet done with life. So disadvantages of inbreeding, a lack of genetic resistance, obviously, to disease, because you've got a lack of genetic variation. That is always a negative. You want in any species as much genetic sort of distinction as possible in order to have more genetic resilience to things like diseases. When lions or leopards have been inbreeding for generations, you also get Down syndrome becomes more common, or a similar effect to Down syndrome. Growth defects, short lives, weak teeth, weak joints. There is an endless list of reasons why inbreeding isn't really something that is allowed for too long in the animal kingdom. It might happen here. It's, you know, we have, say, one generation of inbreeding, not a disaster at all. And of course, they're not bound by our rules, so no problem there. Right. Now that they've relaxed and gone flat, let's try and reposition. Now, Shamsun, this is exactly what happens when leopards are mating. The males go wherever they want to, and the females follow them automatically, regardless of whether or not it takes them into another leopard's territory. She's sitting in Karula's territory right now. That might be one of the reasons why. You can see in her body language, a little bit on edge, a little bit jumpy. It's because she's in another lady's territory, and lady leopards don't appreciate that. But the female leopards are not strong enough or brave enough to challenge a male leopard. And a male leopard is automatically very defensive over the female that he's mating with. So what could happen, potentially, is Karula, and it has been seen before on the live safaris, Karula might come and stand and watch. And you can only imagine the thoughts going through her mind. I'm sure thoroughly unimpressed with the presence of a lady, but not so that she would challenge them. I'm going to try and reposition to get us a better view, because we really are in a not great spot. Lovely. So she's younger than I thought she was. Thank you to Ellen Fowler. We are looking at the older offspring of Inkanyeni, the leopard that has still managed to escape me, but currently has one young cub around Cheetah Plains. She was born in November 2013, so she's nearly three. But she is skittish, that I will say. For a Sabi sand leopard, she's not 100% comfortable. So she's got a spot pattern of 3-3, and Shaluva, by the way, which is something that we knew, means flower, which is a lovely name. So Shaluva the flower, beautiful name for a female leopard. If somebody could explain to me how Shumbambalana came to be called Emerald Spotted Wood Dove, just by the way, that's something that's been interesting me for a long time. Okay, you seem to be okay. Now that I know she's Inkanyeni's daughter, hello girly, can we have a look at you? Can I stop here? Hey, beautiful. I have never seen Inkanyeni, and this is the first time I have ever seen her daughter. I think it was the moth-eaten ears that sort of gave me the impression that she wasn't very young. But now that I look at her, this is absolutely fascinating. She just looks totally different to the Karula line of leopards, or the immediate Karula line, female line. Face is much more elongated. She's stunning. This is truly wonderful. He is totally hidden. We're still not in the best possible spot, I know, with the sun behind them. So I'm going to keep trying. I just wanted to stop and get a view of her and also gauge her behavior, since she is a leopard that I'm unfamiliar with, and I want to make sure that we don't make her uncomfortable. But I think what we can do now is we do a bit of a longer loop, and we will get all the way around to the other side and have a slightly better view. The tricky thing, of course, with positioning a vehicle with mating leopards is as soon as they decide to mate, they immediately move, and they almost invariably move somewhere more tricky. And one last look from this angle at the lovely Shaluva. Ah! Confusion. Confusion reigns. The identity of our lovely leopard. Let's get a spot pattern quickly. Excuse me, girl. Oh, I couldn't quite see. 1, 2, 3. Definitely 3 on her right side. I haven't seen her left side. So she's definitely got a 3. There's some confusion amongst our regular viewers. Some people suggesting that recent videos of Shaluva suggest that she doesn't have those nicks in her ears. I wish she'd give us a yawn. That might actually help us. We could age her by her teeth. Hey girl, do you want to give us a quick yawn? Maybe hop up and mate with Mvula, then we can have a look at your teeth. No, a bit tired. A bit tired and a bit tired of his company, I imagine. Who else could it be, though? Shaluva? It could be a Manuleti leopard, but she's too relaxed. Who am I missing? Well, Canada Keith thinks he saw 4 spots on her top row of her right side. I thought I saw 3, but I'm not 100% sure about that. Let's try and have a look again. But oh, now she's lying with her head resting very comfortably, but also very awkwardly for us to examine her spot patterns. And Canada Keith, it's possible. It's entirely possible. I was told that she was mating with, that Mvula was mating with Shaluva. That, of course, does not mean it's impossible he was intercepted by another female who has taken Shaluva's place. But it does seem a bit of a stretch, doesn't it? That we would encounter 2 lesser-known females in the same area. But maybe the person who originally identified Shaluva got it wrong. I think it's Shaluva. Okay, well, at least I feel comfortable. There you go, spot patterns, guys. It looked like a 3-3, to be honest. However, we have marvelous news. First of all, at least I was right about her being old and not, or older and not young. I do feel truly relieved about this. We have the answer to our mystery, everybody. There are 2 Shaluvas. One is the daughter of Inkanyeni. The other is born in 2007, making her 9 years old rather than 3. So that definitely makes me feel better about my aging of the leopards. I was starting to question my own sanity there when I said to you all, she's not a very young leopard. Well, there we go. She is 9 years old. Her name is Shaluva. And not much is known about her, except that she shares a name with Inkanyeni's cub. So what we'll do is we'll do some extra digging and research, although I fully trust Ellen Fowler's information that she has sent through. I definitely do. But let's see if we, as a collective initiative, don't manage to dig up a little bit more information on our beautiful girl. Hello, Mystery Cat. Turns out you've got the same name as somebody else. You've been causing us much confusion here. Not that you have any idea about that, but perhaps if you did know, it would make you smile slightly. Up we get. Which way are we going to go, lovely lady? To tempt the magnificent Mvula. I'm going to sit on your head behind the tree. Ah. Sorry, everybody, but there's no point repositioning now. We'll get a clear view in a bit later. Oh, Vula, takes him a little while. Isn't that the most incredible sound that they make? Oh, that was an exhausted flop down. Okay, now that they've completed that, let us reposition and try and find ourselves a slightly better spot, because right now we've got bush willow. Right, let's do this. Try and sneak around. I am so excited to see a new leopard. And Brian says brand new for him as well. So with all of the confusion, neither of us have ever seen this particular Shaluva. Shaluva 07. 007 Shaluva or something. I don't know. We'll figure it out. We'll have to make up a name. Not a new name, just a way of distinguishing between the two. While we reposition, let's go over to Brent. I'll catch up with you shortly.
So Jamie's got two cats in the bush, and we've managed to find the biggest cat in the whole of the Sabi Sands. And it's going to be making a lot of noise as it comes towards us. And there's a very big cat coming down the road. This cat is so big it has to be towed. Now, I'm guessing they're on their way to do some work on the Tuma Dam. And the cat is so big they can't drive down vehicle access, so they've had to come down the Buffalo cut line and now down the Gowrie cut line, because there are less trees. Now the leopards are just behind us. Dave and I have been standing by on Gowrie cut line just in case they slip off into the bush. So we're being very patient and waiting for those leopards. I'm quite excited to see the female. Vula, you old stud, what have you found? Who's found you is a better question, because of course female leopards are the ones who initiate a lot of... Oh, I lied, it's not a cat, it's a komatsu. Not a caterpillar, a komatsu. Hello, Mvo. It's very big, that bucket. I think it would crush poor Wendy if it had to sit on Wendy. There's lots of dust. I'm sorry. sorry. Don't cough into the microphone, Brent. So be prepared to watch. Back quickly cross to Jamie and the leopards.
Well, due to leopard form, another very brief mating session. And Abula has decided that he no longer wants to settle where he was before and is searching for a more comfortable patch. He is, look, he's hungry. She's probably scratched him a few times, but he is looking stiff. You can see what I mean. He's not moving with a litheness that we associate with male leopards, and certainly not with the level of agility that when I last saw him, he possessed. I don't know if it's just because it's cold, perhaps a little bit of age and a little bit of repetitive motion when it comes to mating. Perhaps that has made life a bit more tricky. Brent, they're mobile towards you now. I might struggle to get through here. I'm going to try. And hello to Ellen. While we attempt to reposition, hold on everybody, we might take a little while. Ellen wants to know why the male bites the back of the neck of the female while they mate. And the answer is it goes back to our barbed penis conversation. So leopards and lions, the males have barbed penises, which means it catches and it hurts when the male withdraws or moves at all within the female. And she gets cross. She gets naturally rather infuriated with this. She's got the instinct to mate, but she doesn't appreciate the action so much. And so what often happens is she turns around and hits him hard. Now, he grabs the back of her neck in order to stop her from doing this straight away until he has finished mating with her. Thereafter, he lets go and withdraws, and she usually, and that's why I think we've come to the end of this mating period, she usually turns around and smacks him in the face with her paws, or even her back feet. Sometimes she turns around and kicks him with her back feet. So that is why male leopards and male lions, and in fact most of the Panthera species that have this approach to mating, will the males will grab the back of the female's neck. And if we have a look at the back of her neck, we can guarantee that we will see it coated with saliva and a little bit clumped together and uncomfortable looking. The males sometimes even draw blood when they grab the back of the female's neck like that. It's not a gentle process, feline mating. And the reason behind that is because it gives the best genetics a chance to take over. And what I mean by that is because of the protracted period, the female has a better chance of A, mating with several males, tricking them into thinking they're the father, and B, the best chance of the strongest male fertilizing her after mating. So her ovulation has to be induced. It gives time for the best male candidate in the area to make his way in and mate. Where is Tingana, I wonder? He's not going to be happy about this particular scenario. But perhaps he is otherwise occupied. Tingana is the dominant male leopard in this area. Shame, and I think we can let poor old Brent off the hook now. He's been standing by waiting for these leopards to pop out, and they keep going flat. I don't know if he still wants to come in and join us, in which case he's more than welcome, since it's just us, or he's welcome to move on. I can't imagine he's having a ball sitting on the road, waiting for them to come to him. Vula, you're looking exhausted, hey boy? Been a long few days. This is absolutely marvelous. It sounds as though I've just heard Brent's engine start up. Sounds as though he is moving on once again. There he is. Bye. No, he was not far from us at all. Oh, is she going to make another approach? Or is she just seeking out a more comfortable patch of shade? The white tail twitching. I always get the impression with leopards, whenever I see them mating, I always get the impression of slight bitterness and frustration on both sides, in that their solitude has been intruded upon. And there's always a sort of a feeling as though they really don't appreciate each other's company all that much. Instinct has brought them together, but leopards by nature prefer to be alone, particularly the males. I think she's just picking her way into a shady spot. She's also very hungry. They both are. They've got empty bellies and a flap of skin showing, which is almost inevitable with a mating couple like this. They don't really stop to eat. They doze, but they don't really eat or hunt. Sometimes they do, if the opportunity presents itself, but they don't actively go searching for food. And that means that by the end of 5 days frequent activity, they find themselves very hungry and quite tired. Here we go, in again. See that fury? Sorry, we tried to get the branches out of the way, but that was over quicker than I thought it would be. Grrr, Niels girl, you cross. Could see there that brief swat at his face. That was so funny. Did you see Impalas's response there? No, lady. Not again. Not right now. He just gave her such an angry look. Teeth yellow, canines bared. And hello to James. And welcome on our sunrise safari. You want to know how many females the male cats mate with before they are finished? Oh, it depends on what you mean by finished. A male leopard or a male lion has a brief tenure where they are dominant and able to mate with a female in the area. And that, the several females in their territory, because a male leopard's territory is larger than a female's. That means that a male leopard's territory could encompass three females, or even more so, in certain areas, three or four females. They'll come into estrus every couple of weeks until they fall pregnant, at which point they won't come back into estrus for another at least a year, up to a year and a half. So, sure, how many times? I mean, a male leopard mates about 500 times each time a female goes into estrus. And he'll mate with as many different females as he can encounter. We've got a case here of a male, a dispersal male, mating with a female, so he doesn't even have a territory. And what I'm trying to say, James, in a long and unintentionally convoluted way, is I have absolutely no idea. It depends on the individual leopard, it depends on the circumstances. You're probably looking at about 15 individuals that a male leopard will encounter and mate with. If that would probably be the maximum in a high leopard density area. Mvula has mated with Shaluva, Karula, Itandi, or, hello, she's going again. Told you, leopards is very frequent. Oh, shame, boy. Such a plaintive look. The sounds of a leopard mating pair are just incredible. And that's what I heard ages ago when I got out on the road and said to you there's tracks of there's tracks of something. But my brain was a bit slow on the uptake. It's just these gentle rumbling growls emanating from both of them. That's what I mean when I say they're terribly unimpressed with each other. But I suppose when mating is as discomforting as it is for both parties, you cannot expect them to be terribly enthusiastic. We're going to reposition and see if we can't get you a better view. We're almost at the road at this point. It's been a steady process in that direction. Poor Brent, he was waiting around. He's now since lost patience and moved off. Let's find out where he's going.
I didn't lose patience. I got moved by the final control. But on the exciting note, we're on our way to go check on those gorgeous little lion cubs. And I've just heard there are cheetah tracks crossing into Juma. So we're going to check at the lion den, see if mom's around. If mom's not around, we'll have a quick look and then we'll leave. If mom's around, we'll spend some time with those bundles of joy. And after that, I think we're going to go track a cheetah with Taxon. And I'm just going to get a hold of Tax quickly on the radio. I just want to see exactly where those cheetah tracks are. Taxi, where do those Nkonzo cross cheetah cut lines, sorry? Copy, thanks. I'm near Buffelsook. I'm just going to check the Ngala Kaya and then I'll come give you a hand. Okay, so the cheetah tracks are not too far from here, but let's not get too focused on cheetah when we're right where the lion cubs could be. So I'm just going to get Dave to come out wide and we can have a look how there's this very, very steep little drainage line. Oh, look, look, look there, Dave. African hawk eagle. Oh, isn't that stunning? Now, fortunately, those cubs are a bit big for an African hawk eagle to grab. I think because it's quite cold in the morning, those cubs are going to be piled on top of each other. So if mom's here, we can spend some time with them. If she's not, we'll have a very quick look and then we'll move on. Okay. So we need to peer down into this little river system. It is possible Mom might have moved the den because they're not where they were yesterday. And they could be right up against here where we can't see. But yesterday they were right under in there. Now, Mom might have moved them. She does that. They're not underneath here. So it looks like Mom's actually moved the cubs, and that's probably a good thing. So what lions do is, have you got something? Oh, there they are. Hello, little bundles of joy. Mom is not here. So they've moved out of the drainage line. They're in the little, the fallen down knobthorn thicket. Hello, little guys. I can't see Mom, and they are in a very thick area, but nice to know she actually is still here. She probably will be moving them soon in the next couple of days because they have been here for over a week. Normally, lions don't tend to keep the same den site for more than 10 or so days. Now, the smell of regularly going to an area is what will give away their position. So, to stop hyenas and other predators finding the cubs, they normally move them about once every 10 days. Oh, they are so cute. Oh, little yawn. Enjoying the sun. I'm quite sure they're going to crawl deeper into that little thicket as it gets warmer to get some shade. You hear a bird alarm calling. Is Mom on her way back in behind us? Can you have a look for me there, Dave? No. Okay, well, we're not going to spend time while Mom's not here. We're going to leave those little bundles of joy to themselves. And hopefully Mom will be here this afternoon and we can spend a bit more time with them. Good spot there, Dav. I was so concentrated on looking down that I didn't look up. Okay, so we're going to go look for that cheetah. I just need to be on the Game Drive channel a bit while we try to figure out where to look for that cheetah that's on Juma. So while we do that, let's go back to Jamie and the leopards.
Fantastic timing. Here we go. She didn't even turn around that time. She just looks a little bit angry. But she didn't even try to turn around and smack him. Now, initially, when leopard mating first starts, female turns around, she rakes at him with her back legs as soon as he moves to go off her. She kicks at him. There's a huge amount of aggression, and the noise is even more spectacular than the noises we are hearing now. But I'm just trying to calculate roughly in my head how many times they've mated since I first found them. And we're quite far away from that set of tracks, so they probably mated a couple of times before we found them, at least twice. They've mated probably about 10 times. She's going again. Oh, boy. Oh. It's just because you're good looking, Mvula. She can't help herself.
No, 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 no.
Right, so that was within the space of about a minute and 30 seconds of each other. I've probably mated about 15 times since we first got here, because while you were with Brent, they mated twice, very fast. That's a good point from Rachel. Now, Rachel said, isn't Vula's gene quality potentially weakened with age? And she says, no disrespect to Mvula, and of course none of us, all of us are incredibly fond of the great, not quite fallen king, clearly, since he's still managing to mate. Rachel says, is he not a bad choice? Not really. Yes, certainly there's a decline, an inevitable decline in fertility. There might be a decline, oh dear. Oh goodness, this is going to get tricky. She can't search for him, he's gone into hiding. At this point, I imagine he's considering witness protection programs to get him away. Okay, guys, we better move, otherwise we are going to lose them. Rachel, I don't think he's a bad choice. It's the interesting thing, I mean, males versus females. Most male species stay fertile and virile until they reach the end of their lifespan. It's the females that go through the menopause. They've got a limited production of eggs in their lives. Is he still here? I'm just trying to see exactly where he is, because I don't want to drive on top of him if he is here. Is he somewhere in... Oh yes, there he is. Oh, sorry boy, I was about to come round you there. That's definitely not going to work. Oh, you picked a difficult spot. I think that might have been the intention. Okay, in that case, Brian and myself will forge a different path around. It's going to be difficult. We've got quite a few trees in our way. I don't think Mvula is a bad choice, to be 100% honest with you. I think he's still... Look, one or two, there might be a limit to his fertility. It might be reduced, but he'll still be fertile. And his genes will be absolutely fine, because that you've got that constant production of sperm. It's not like the ovum, which is, as I said, limited in number. You're born with the number of eggs that you are going to produce within your life if you're a female mammal. I mean, of course, not every leopard mating is successful. Sorry, Brian, you okay there? I don't want to hit you with a leadwood. Just like couples trying for children often have to try repeatedly in order to fall pregnant. Okay, we're taking the long way around. Oh no. Oh dear, it's all gone very wrong.
Not the best news in the world. At the moment, I'm trying to limp homeward. Wendy is not behaving as well as an old vintage lady should. The clutch is slipping and the accelerator is sticking, which makes for quite interesting time. So we'll bumble along, and then suddenly the accelerator will just go boom, and we go fast, then we go slowly. So we can have two vehicles out on the sunset safari. I'm going to start limping home, but I'm going to limp home past where the cheetah tracks went. So we still got a chance of seeing that cheetah. If not, hopefully it'll be around this evening. I definitely think with the lack of water around, it's a very good idea to keep an eye on the Juma Dam cam during the day. Who knows? That, and it's a single cheetah. Maybe it's even a female. Oof, exciting stuff. But let's keep an eye out on the Juma Dam camp during the day. I'm going to meander in the area the tracks were going. The tracks haven't crossed Drakensberg Road, but they might. And hopefully they'll cross in front of us with a cheetah in the tracks. We can hope. Now, it would be a long time since we actually last saw a cheetah in Juma. The last cheetah I saw in Juma was actually on foot on my off afternoon with Nicola Austin, of all people. And we were having a chat, and this cheetah chased an impala past us on quarantine clearings. Very exciting, exciting afternoon that was. And that was a single male cheetah. I'm hoping this is a single female cheetah, and I'm hoping she decides to have cubs on quarantine. Now, as nice as that would be for us, it's probably not good for the cheetah due to our hyena, lion, and leopard densities around quarantine. And those cubs probably wouldn't survive too long. But I have yet to see... yet to see a female cheetah since I've been in Safari Live. I've seen three different male cheetah, but no females. I've found female cheetah tracks, but never actually found the cheetah that makes those tracks. Oh dear. We're running. I can't control the car. No, I can. But it isn't healthy. So, as I said, we are... There we go. We've got some kudus here. Hello, little one. There's a young sub-adult kudu. Oh, and one lone impala who thinks he's a kudu. And to the right of the male there we go. Chilling. Look, he looked like he was following the kudu around. Now, it's not uncommon to get mixed antelope associations. And the more eyes there are, the better to spot the predator with. And the less odds you are going to be the one who's eaten. See, if I was an antelope, I'd cozy up to any other baby antelope of another species, because they are the most likely to be eaten. Now, Brian, up until about 2 months ago, I would have said, very, very rare and no, Brian, to do the antelopes interbreed. But now, in northern Botswana, for the first time ever, there is a, what are they calling it? A watchwee, which is a cross between a waterbuck and a lechwe. And it is in the Cylinder Reserve in northern Botswana. And this is the first recorded case, but they are both of the cobus family. But it is the first case. Now, between an impala and a kudu, probably it would never really work. But between a kudu and a nyala, there is a possibility it might work. They are from the same family. But generally what happens when these, if it does happen, and it's very rare in the wild for it to happen, normally it happens when people put them in a closed space together. But if it does happen, the offspring, or the watchwee, or what would you call it, a kudu and a nyala combination, Dave? Nyadu. Nyadu or dunya. Generally that nyadu or duya or watchwee will be unable to produce offspring, so they will be barren. But it is possible, but the antelope have to be of the same family. So the same family, we've got bushbuck, inyala, and kudu. But impala, being on their own family, there wouldn't be any chance. Okay. Hi, Lucy. Lucy's in South Bend, Indiana, and obviously one of our regulars. Always great to have you on the vehicle, Lucy. Lucy would like to know how the drought is going to affect the antelope births and how many of them will survive. Oh, sorry, there's a noisy radio. And you probably find a lot of them are going to expire. I'd say in the droughts, maybe only 10 or 15% will survive. And when it comes to the seasonal breeders like warthog, they're not an antelope though, but wildebeest and impala, it's going to be very difficult to say. So I think the birthing will probably happen, but whether the females are going to be able to lactate successfully, produce enough milk for the offspring, we're only going to be able to tell come November. And of course we might have rain before then, so it might be lush and wonderful, and the females that survive the drought will be able to produce much luscious milk for the new offspring. But as again, I think it's probably the best way to put it is, out here everything's not an exact science. Well, I suppose it is, but a lot of stuff we're guessing, and we can't really say for sure till it happens. So we're going to have to wait and see. With things like buffalo, you probably find they've got nearly a 90% mortality rate on calves at the moment because of the drought. And that's because they're bulk grazers, so they're not so picky, and because they live in big herds, they have to cover now big distance between water and food, and that's what's probably causing a lot of trouble for the youngsters. And as you can see, there's barely a blade of grass around. Okay, so we are limping home in hope of a cheetah. But while talking about one spotted cat, let's go to two that we actually have.
And surprise, surprise, Wendy's clutch has decided not to work anymore. Shame, poor Wendy's been giving us considerable clutch trouble over the last week and a half. Sad to hear that it has gone once again. Nevertheless, we have managed to reposition and rejoin our two leopards. At the moment, I can only see one leopard, although I'm sure Mvula is not too far off in that patch of bushes behind her. This is the only possible place that we can go for now. So if she does move, if she does go to mate with him, we won't really be able to get a good view at all. And that's just because there are so many trees. The road is tantalizingly close, a nice open area where we might be able to reposition at will. But for now, we remain in the block with the lovely Shuluva. Just in terms of size, because I think it's difficult for you guys to get a sense of scale. Ah, there we go. Hello, girl, with your beautiful eyes. Apparently, this coming through from Karen, Shuluva is the older sister to Inkanyeni. So not Inkanyeni's daughter, it is the older sister to Inkanyeni. She is the older sister to Inkanyeni. Thank you, Karen. So we've got a little bit of a better idea as to how the leopard genetics are working here. And Brent does just want to talk to me on the Game Drive channel. Give me 1 second. Standing by. Copy, let me know if you need help. Brent seems to think that he needs to pass that message on, that he might have to walk home if he doesn't take Wendy back right this second. So Wendy had best limp home as quickly as possible. We definitely don't want our poor crew having to stroll on back. That would be most tragic. Right, and back to our lovely Shuluva. Karen? Thank you so much for that information. It is fascinating. What I was trying to say earlier was, in terms of size, it's very difficult for you all watching on the other side of the camera to get an idea. Although I think in comparison to Mvula, it might help you a little bit, because most of you have seen at least Karula mating with Mvula at some point or another. She's taller, ever so slightly. Karula Shadow and Tundi come from a line of leopards that are quite short. Particularly, I've noticed, I feel it with Tundi, she's almost a mini leopard. She's terribly sweet, although she more than makes up with that with her spitfire attitude. She's a tiny leopard, though. The Inkanyeni family branch, I don't think she's not massive, Shaluva, but she is a little bit taller and a little bit lankier than Karula and Karula's female offspring. I'm not sure exactly where the connection lies, but there will be, as with all female leopards in an area like this, a degree of relatedness, but I'm talking in immediate family, so direct descendants, rather than cousins, first cousins, second cousins, and half-siblings. She's beautiful, though. Her eye colour almost matches that of Mvula. I love Mvula's eye colour. There's a certain glow to it that is lovely to look at. Oh, girl, you're trying to find a nice, comfortable spot there. Now, I said that not every mating is successful. And it isn't. We've seen it before with Tingana. In fact, it even got to the point where we were, not we, some people were casting aspersions upon a poor Tingana's ability to father cubs. There were accusations flying around that perhaps he might be sterile. He's not. It was just that not every leopard mating is successful. Natasha, hello and welcome, watching all the way in Ontario. I have absolutely no idea what the average success rate is for successful fertilization. So what I assume you mean by that is how often does a mating session, a full estrus session, result in a pregnancy? Natasha, if I had to guess, but it is entirely a guess, and it certainly will be different around the world, it will be different with individual leopards, it will be different in different areas. If I had to guess, I would put it somewhere at around 40 to 50%. It is a pure guess. And the reason I say that is you usually see female leopards mating about twice before they then fall pregnant. Oof, it is such a difficult one, though. That really is. That's a thumb-sucked percentage. I'll be completely honest with you. It's totally sucked out of my thumb. One thing I can do is have a look and see whether there's been any research into it. While the wounded Wendy and its courageous crew limp their way back to camp, let us head across to them so that they can describe in detail their journey to you all.
Cool. You never know quite what Wendy's going to do. So as you're going along and you see a steep bank coming, and you put your clutch in and you try to change gears, except the clutch doesn't catch. So you then attempt to climb said hill in third gear. And then the accelerator sticks, so once you get to the top, it suddenly you take off. Oh, like that. So we are going to try and get this sorted out by OPA as fast as possible. So we are limping straight back into camp. And I was actually quite worried that we might not make it all the way back to camp. I am no mechanic, and so I do know a little bit about vehicles, and I know enough to say this is a problem that is above and beyond my skill set. So I'm going to take it to someone who has the skill set. I'm hoping, let me not jinx it, but I don't think they're major problems. I think it's probably a bit of tweaking of the master cylinder on the clutch, we just put a new one in, and on the accelerator, with the amount of dust and gunk and stuff, it could just be a lot of stuff that's causing that accelerator cable to stick open, and that's what I'm hoping. Fingers crossed. Hi, Soraya and a Dr. Rob in New Jersey. They'd like to know what I'd do if an elephant charged me and my vehicle wouldn't start. I'd have a very stern word with the elephant. I might use some very choice language. There's a wonderful Afrikaans word that all animals seem to understand. Futsak, which is a very strong term, go away. And I think Afrikaans is a wonderful word to shout in because it's so descriptive. Futak! See, it's not futsak, futak! That generally works with most animals, elephants. Probably a bit of, hey, futak, futak, futak! Something like that generally stops the charge. Dave thinks that's quite funny. I have used bad language at an elephant before, but I've matured, and these days I try not to swear at the animals when they're charging. I tend to just give them a stern word. Oh, look at that! A family of Natal Franklins scurrying across the road after their morning forage on quarantine. They've done really well. So they had 5 chicks, and they've still got 4. And out in this part of the world, to get that many to that size is very impressive. Okay, let's see if the car makes it the last 100 meters. And it does have a mind of its own at the moment. So I think I'm going to go straight over the pit. And so Opa can have access to the underneath the inner workings of the Wendela. Fortunately, we are very lucky to have Opa close by and on hand for such moments. Because if it was left to us to fix the car, I don't think we'd ever go on game drive. There would only be a bushwalk. We are definitely not the best mechanics. So there we go. For those of you who've never been into the Juma workshop, here we are. And there is Opa. Opa is, of course, also a great panel beater, and he's busy remaking a Juma vehicle. But here we go. Say hello, Opa. Opa is going to help me try to figure out what's wrong with this car at the moment. So from Dangerous Dave, the dish with the dimples, and myself, Brent, it's been fantastic. Great to have you on vehicle. Sorry about the angle grinder going in the background, but I'm hoping we can get this vehicle fixed as soon as possible so we'll be ready for the sunset safari in a few short hours. But toodles for now.
Brent will definitely be ready for the sunset safari because luckily we have Herbert on board. He will be able to walk with us, so never fear, even if poor old Wendy is not ready, we will have a walk out and about. Oh, goodness gracious! Ta-da! We have made it. Here we go, we have our courting couple and other alliterative answers to it. And we do have other vehicles coming into the sighting at this point, so whilst we've been fortunate to have it all to ourselves, oh, here we go again. A very reluctant Vula and a very determined Shluva. Hi, yours. Here we go once again. Oh. She decided they were too out in the open and that perhaps the protection of that bush would be better. Hello, gorgeous boy. And he's going to search once again for a spot of shade, making his way towards the road. Let's see if he keeps going or if he lies down once again. I think he's going to keep moving. I think he's going to come towards the road. Oh, maybe not. While Vula sniffs the ground where Shluva was lying a little bit earlier, James Richard, yes, because the leopard mating is such a noisy affair, it absolutely attracts attention. Look at those teeth. You can judge a leopard's age from their teeth. He gave a little bit of a phlegm and grimace there. It was a half-hearted one, but there was a phlegm and grimace. Now, James, yes, absolutely. As they walk towards us. Oh, extraordinary. Well, as he walks past us. Right past Eeyore's vehicle. Imagine being in that vehicle. It's the most awesome feeling in the world. Yes, the noise attracts attention, and yes, that is dangerous for them, as is their level of distraction. We saw Tingana and Karula have a very, being cutesy, a very narrow escape from the Tsalala pride when they were mating around Arethusa a good few months ago. And for Mvula, it's even more dangerous because, yes, absolutely it could attract Tingana's attention. We certainly hope that it doesn't. And sometimes what happens is with male leopards, they actually share the female. They don't even necessarily fight over her. But sometimes they do. And when they do, it can be vicious. Thank you. Shluva. Shluva. 2007, yeah. Perfect. There's two Shluvas apparently. Perfect.
Mother is beacon female, father is your don.
Mother is beacon female, father is your don. Thank you, yours. You guys go ahead. Alright guys, we're going to let the others go through, in theory. Perhaps they can forge a path for us to get out of this block. We've been doing a lot of path forging. Let me try and move out of everybody's way. This is tricky. Usually we would go over to Brent, but since he is having an early morning, he's going to, we're going to try and do this all together. They're on Gari Cutline. This actually is going to be our last view. Oh no, and I've unplugged myself. Sorry, Kirst. I hope you weren't trying to speak to me because I wouldn't have heard you. Kirsty says she was ignoring me. It's very rude. I gave her mating leopards this morning. Okay. How do we feel about flat tires, everybody? Worth the risk? Worth the risk. Oh. Safari Dean is absolutely right. Opa is the true hero of safari life, and this is why. Ooh. You okay there, Brian? Cool. I've got a ripped muscle in my ribs. That's all right. Shake it off. Try and dodge the leadwood trees, which obviously we don't drive over. That is illegal. Here we go. Safari Dean is 100% right. The vehicles obviously work very, very hard, and Opa in turn works very, very hard at keeping them together. And he does a marvelous job, and unfortunately, we have just missed them disappearing into the most, good there, Brian, impossible spot. Sorry, they've been flat the whole time. Shluva. I think Ephraim's testing me. He's got a smile all over his face. Okay. This is where it gets impossible for us, A, to follow, and B, to have signal, guys. So although we've had a marvelous morning, which is becoming my new favorite phrase because it alliterates so nicely, we have potentially reached the end of Rusty's ability. We don't, as wonderful as Opa is, we don't need to test his skill anymore. We've had a great time with them. I can't go in there. Oh, there they are. Never mind, I'm an idiot. Can you see over there, Brian? Here we go. We've got surprise last view, depending on whether or not they stay here. Oh yes, so we were talking about their noisiness and the potential to draw attention to themselves. Shamsun, I heard them mating at, what was I at? I was probably, how far do you think we drove? Maybe about 500 meters before we found them. So we first heard the mating at 500 meters. Now my hearing, whilst it is not terrible, is certainly not at the same level of a leopard or a lion. So probably, Shamsun, a leopard or a lion could hear this at 2 miles, even more so. So about 4 or 5 kilometers, if not more so. And Karula has been known to abandon whatever she is doing to follow up on the sounds of mating leopards inside her territory. And if Tingana is in the vicinity, things are going to change immensely for them. Let me just let the guys know that we've still got them because they've now raced off in search of them. When Taxon does arrive, then it will be time for us to leave. Yours, I've still got visual, at least of them, Fuzz. She's flat, still up on the other side of the drainage here. There's the male. No, there's a female. Copy, I'll keep you updated as Makulu block here. I can't visual about 0, 1 out of 5. Here we go. Coming back. And we're going to mate again. We'll hear it, if not see it. He actually approached her that time, which was interesting, from what I could see briefly, in flashes of spots through the trees. Oh, and although you wouldn't have heard it, he just gave the most exhausted sigh. This is definitely something we will be following up on the sunset safari. I'm sure they will still be in the vicinity, and given the wide distance that the sound of mating leopards travel, we've got a very, very good chance of finding them again, even if we have to leave them in the next few moments. Definitely become a lot more tricky to see them. And Kathy's been thinking about the same scenario that I've been picturing, which is what would happen if Tingana came running in. We've got a couple of scenarios. One is that Mvula would just run straight. The other is that they would lie next to each other and growl at each other. The other is that they would both mate with the same female. And the reason I say that is because there have been several recorded sightings of two relatively dominant males that have reached an understanding and a standoff almost, a kind of a realization that they are equally matched. And what they'll do in that situation is, while they might be unhappy about it, they'll actually take turns mating with a female. That's what I've never seen it, but I have heard about it. I think it must be the most extraordinary sighting to witness. I would suggest that what would happen would there would be a great deal of noise, that Tingana and Mvula would lie just like Shimbambalana and Quarantine did not too long ago. They would lie a good couple of meters from each other, growl furiously, and one of them would eventually give in and move off, and that would probably be Mvula. But we don't know. I mean, it's very much a hypothetical. In this case, we know what I know from experience. I've seen when another male is interrupted, the one and only time I've seen that, the smaller male just ran away. But I don't know what would be the case here, because Mvula, even though he has been moving outside of his old territory, he's been pushed to become nomadic, He probably still has those dominant instincts within him. Would he fight or would he give in? Absolutely no idea. She's up for another round. Half-heartedly for both of them. And he's just growling it over now. Thoroughly unimpressed with the idea. Now that's interesting. So Shaluba might be even older than expected. Karen, apparently you say 2005 makes her 11, but same age as Karula. I have to be honest, that was what I first heard and first thought when I saw her. I'd heard a rumor that there was another female of around Karula's age with a neighboring territory. But I wasn't certain enough in the information that I'd been given to put it forward. So 2005 makes absolute sense to me, and she really doesn't look like a young leopard at all. And Shamsun, where does she live? She lives around the northern tip, the northwestern tip of Karula's territory. So Karula extends throughout Ajuma. She shares the boundary with Shadow. Shaluva goes to Sydney's Dam. The Sydney's Dam is the sort of boundary with Karula. And then up into the Manuleti and a great deal of Buffalo's Hook. I think that if we could question yours, he'd probably tell us that they see her relatively regularly around the Buffalo's Hook region. So that's essentially, for those of you for whom that is essentially Pig Latin, it is the territory to the north of Karula's territory. And they are roughly close to the same age. So welcome, meet Shaluva. The older sister of Inkanyeni, born in 2005, apparently. Yes, older sister of Inkanyeni, born in 2005. And her niece, Shaluva's older daughter. No, Inkanyeni's older daughter is also called Shaluva. There you go. Clear as mud for all of you who wanted a little bit of an explanation and some clarity there. Definitely glad I could provide. We've just got two flicking tails at the moment, and that's pretty much the view that we have. Unfortunately, I think that sort of means the end of our sighting. I just want to get onto the Game Drive channel before we leave to make sure nobody else wants to come and find them, because their chances of spotting them without knowing where they are relatively slim. They're both flat for now. I'm trying to see if I can see a way in for you. Poor yours. He wants to come and see. Copy. They're still quite far from going into the drainage itself. I've got visual from where I am. Hold on. They seem to be up. Nope, she's just mating again. You're welcome to Tax. Sorry, everybody. Let's just make sure we stay here until Taxon and them get here so that they know where to go. You might not be able to see, but you can hear. Oh, yours keep coming. He's now mobile to a bit more into the open. Coming straight towards you now. Awesome. Negative for now. Let's just see if he goes flatter. Keep coming, Tax, towards me. Where did he go? Is he still walking? Yes, he's still walking. Walking towards yours. Okay. All we're going to do is we're going to show Tax in and get a visual of him. Here, our tax goes straight into the firebreak. He's going to go down in there. There goes our female. Last view of the lovely Shaluva. And then we shall leave them be, because things have got very tricky. There we go. Let us not abandon hope just yet. I just want to make sure, because if they do cross into Biffle's Hook, then my plan for finding them on the afternoon sunset safari will be scuppered. We will not be able to follow up there because we can't drive in that area. So before we go racing off, let's just make sure we establish the direction that they're going in. I think they're just looking for some shade. They might be looking for some food as well, though. I'm a little bit concerned about even Rusty's signal in this drainage system, though. Where does it look like the people are all looking? Oh, they're in the drainage system now. No, there's only space for two vehicles here. Cool. Oh, wait, up onto the drainage line. Where are you guys planning on going? She's going to lie down there on the drainage line wall. We have marvelous news in that wounded Wendy might not be so wounded. And you might be seeing Brent once again before the end of the sunrise safari. But for now, we can keep you occupied because we actually have a relatively decent view. Do you think our signal's going to work down there, Brian?
We can try.
Should we try? Sorry, Kirst. We're going to give it a go. If we disappear from your screens, don't go away, everybody. I think this might be the easiest way of doing things for now. Don't want to go too deep in case we lose our signal completely. Now, Charlotte, with all of the up-and-coming leopards... Shame. Poor Tax is trying to offer me a spot. No problem, Tax. I think we'll lose signal if we go into the Shkova. Right. Sorry, Charlotte. Didn't mean to interrupt my answer to you. So Charlotte's thinking about all of the up-and-coming leopards and was wondering if there's enough territory to go around and whether or not the dominant leopards automatically make space. It's a balance that is struck. And it differs from place to place, Charlotte. So if there's lots of impala and it's a really idyllic place, then leopard territories just get smaller. But in the northern Sabi sands, which is where we are, their territory sizes are much larger and relatively well established. So what will happen is, to be completely honest with you, a lot of our leopard characters are reaching not the end of their lives, but the end of their lifespans as a territorial leopard. We think Mvula's already pretty much got there. So he is going to be pretty much nomadic from here on out and just dodging the other leopard species. And that's what young males do as well. Now, there's only so many males that make it to the dominance age and successfully manage to establish themselves the territory. Females, it's sort of equally the case that The mothers will pass on bits of their territory. Their territory will get smaller and smaller, but they also get older and older. And for Karula, she could live up to 18 years old, but she is 12 now. And chances are this could well be the last litter that she has before she... And even old female leopards often disperse and become nomadic. So that's how the leopard population deal with the sort of the conflict of territories, the conflict of areas. I have absolutely no idea where the other leopard has gone. I think they might be further into the drainage system. We'll stick with our view for now, as it might be the last. They're very, very close to our boundary, so there is a chance that we won't be able to follow up on the sunset safari. The one thing I'm going to do as soon as I finish drive is to tap into the bush telegraph and find out where Tingana is, or where he's suspected to be. Because even if they haven't found him this morning, they will have a rough idea as to last tracks. But this is close to the boundary of Tingana's territory, this Buffalo's or Cutline area. Oh, I see a tail in the sand. I don't even think Brian will be able to see it from where he is. There, down. Can you see it from that angle, Brian? The only indication that there's a leopard there. The flick of their ever-moving tails. Cool. What a exciting way. It's been a long time since we've seen mating leopards. And when I heard that Imvula was mating close to Sydney's dam, I didn't begin to dare hope that he would potentially bring her here. Marvellous to meet a new leopard, and also wonderful to have mating leopards once again. They came as a bit of a surprise. Hey Brian, we accomplished what we set out to do. We got the static sighting, so we didn't have to drive anywhere, or at least not far, in the chilly morning air. And now the sun is right up, and that's actually why they've slowed down, by the way, in terms of their mating. They go through those bursts of activity, but now that it gets warmer and warmer, they're going to be quite content to settle in the shade and catnap for the rest of the day. Also better be careful because there are lots of lions around. My mistake, the Wounded Wendy saga continues. Wounded Wendy might not be out. Wounded Wendy and her courageous crew might not be out by the end of the sunrise safari, in which case, guys, I'm going to take this opportunity for us to love and leave the leopards and to carry on and move off in search of something else. Unless Kirsty in the next 2 seconds gives me a very strict command to stay, in which case I will, of course, naturally obey. Kirsty says, as long as I go find some Ellie's. Standing by. That's affirmative. They are static for now in the drainage line just to the east of Gari Cutline, right? Best approach is in the firebreak itself. I'm leaving the sighting now with a tax on yours. That's affirmative. You should be able to make your way. If you come along Gari Cutline, come towards Gari Cutline and towards Buffalo's or Cutline, but on the fire break on the eastern side of that road, you'll see tax on yours. Okie dokie, let's go find some elephants, folks. Marvelous mating leopards. We're giving other people a chance to go in. Bernie's on his way. So we shall move off and see what else we can find. Rusty's creaking along gently, having just been quite actively moving through the trees and the bushes of the area. She seems to be just fine, though. Well done, Rusty. Okie dokie. Bear with me one moment. I think I am too warm. I need to take off a jacket, which means taking off an earpiece as well at the same time. So at this point, I won't be able to hear any questions or updates just yet. There we go. Pretty much Whoopsie. We very briefly nearly went off the road there. Oh, that time we did. There we go. All is sorted. And we are on the search for the elephants. Let's just see if Brent's still around in the game drive comms. Brent? He's ignoring me. Not listening. Ah, there we go. He made it. Brent, where did you leave those in Glove? Copy, thanks. There you go. Just getting an update about where Brent left his herd of elephants this morning. They're just around the corner, which is exactly what I thought and exactly what I was hoping for. The suspense was killing me, waiting to find out if Wounded Wendy would make her way back out again. But Opa, once again, as Safari Dean says, proving to be the true hero of the operation. Opa has fixed Wendy. She's back up and running. Let's find out what they're going to do for the last part of their drive.
So we are back. Yay! Well, now, at least my diagnosis was correct. It was the slave cylinder on the clutch that was giving those problems. Now, what happens... There's actually supposed to be a spring on our clutch, and for some reason there is none, and I don't know where it's gone. So what happens if you push the clutch all the way in, it pulls the slave cylinder all the way out, and that's what happens, and that's why we're missing. So now I've got to half push the clutch in, and this is just to get us through for the last bit of drive. Then Opa is going to fashion a spring and to put it in there. So fortunately, oh, much better. And the accelerator cable was exactly what I thought it was. It was a buildup of dust and gunk that was causing the accelerator cable to stick. So we just sprayed a bit of WD-40 on it, and that was right as rain. As I said, I know a little bit about car maintenance. I can often diagnose the problem, but ask me to fix it is a different story. So guys, I know I've been off the radio for a while, so which female leopard was Mvula mating with? I'd love to know, so if anyone does know... So this was Shaluva, the 2005 Shaluva. So I would really, really like to know a bit more about her. I don't know about her, I only know about the younger Shaluva. Who was her mom? Where is she from? So if you guys have any of that info, please send it through to me, questions@wildearth.tv or #SafariLive on Twitter. Now that is fascinating. So I don't know, I'm speculating. I'm sure some of you might know a bit more about Shaluva than I do. Now this is going to be very confusing. We've got two Shaluvas. So we can probably, what do you think we should do? We can call it 2005, so she's quite old. We've got, I'm trying to think, I know. How would you decide between the two Shaluvas? They've got the same name. So Shaluva old and Shaluva new, but that's a bit boring. We can do a bit better than that. Well, I will have to think about it. But again, any information would be wonderful. Hi, a Penny a Pine. A Penny Pine's wondering, where did the original game safaris... Oh, there are lion tracks here. Going straight up the road. We'll follow them for a while. Penny Pine's wondering, did the original game safari start in Kenya? Yes. But the sort of original off-road crashing, and like we have in the Sabi Sands, was actually started in the Sabi Sands. private reserve, was originally Sabi Sands. So the safari industry started in Kenya as an offshoot of the original Kenyan hunting industry. So while the men were out shooting, the ladies would go on safari, and then it turned out that some men didn't want to shoot everything. Very confusing. Okay. Let's make sure the lions didn't go down this big path. They didn't. And so that's how it originally started. So while the men were out hunting, the ladies would be taken around by generally a junior professional hunter as their guide and take them to see the animals rather than shoot them. And that is how the beginning of the sort of safari business in Kenya started. But in terms of private land and lodges, the first place to operate like we operate on a daily basis was just to the south of us, or the southeast of us, and it was Mala Mala. Shortly after Mala Mala came Londolozi, and then Sabi Sabi. Those are the three sort of originals, the sort of oldest, longest standing of the commercial safari lodges in the Sabi Sands. Now, of course, there are lots and lots of them. I wonder where that line went. Tracks of a single male lion that I saw, but there's been quite a few cars and a tractor even on this road already this morning, so they might have continued straight down, or they might have ducked off to the west. I haven't seen any tracks going off to the east. Thanks very much, Karen, who's given me a little bit more information on Shiluva 2005. Born to the Beacon female, who was the dominant female in Biffle's Hook for many years. And she's the older sister of Inkanyeni. Oh, she must be a beautiful leopard. That Beacon female's lineage is very good looking. So I think she probably holds most of her territory in the southern Manuleti, and because she is mating is the reason she has moved down onto Juma. So as I'm sure Jamie said, it's not uncommon for female leopards to move well out of their territory while mating. Well, I try to figure out where these lions have gone. Let's go across to Jamie, who's with some elephants that Dave and I limped past a little earlier.
There we go. We have found the elephants that Kirsty put in a request for. Admittedly, in a very dense spike thorn thicket around a vulture's nest. Luckily for us, I spy one on the edge of the road. We might be able to sidle up a bit closer and get a good view of it. There you go. A shape of grey. Oh, we might not need to. Hello, little one. Now, although we can't see them, we do know that we are absolutely surrounded by elephants at this point. I can hear them in a sort of a 180 degree angle. In fact, more than that, 270 all around me. Just enjoying an early morning feed. Let us try and find a good position to watch them. We have just been with our leopards producing the next generation of little leopard cubs. And of course, we've got such a contrast here between the mothering of the elephant calves, like this one, and the mothering of little leopard cubs. Now, although the maternal bond in both cases is phenomenally strong, the elephants will suckle from their mother for up to 3 years before they are fully weaned. Now, Annie, you were wondering if perhaps the length of time that they take to use their trunk, or to learn how to use their trunk, perhaps has something to do with the time at which the incredible length of time it takes them to be weaned. There could well be a connection. I think that their digestive, I think it has to do with a couple of things. I think that the social structure of elephants has allowed that lengthy maternal care that is presented to all elephant offspring. I think that the herd structure has sort of permitted for that, whereas a solitary animal like a leopard, for example, might have to wean her cubs sooner. Lions, of course, are a good contrast because they are social, but they have to hunt. They have to be able to leave their cubs and go out hunting, and lactating does take a great deal of resource away from the body. I think the fact that they are herbivores makes a big difference because they can have access to resources easily to sustain themselves. Sense. We do have a tiny little baby. Make sure we don't scare anybody here. Hello, guys. Don't worry. There we go. Thank you very much. We come sit next to you. There we go. To illustrate the point being made about an elephant baby learning to use its trunk. Also, sometimes coordination takes a little while. That includes navigating the obstacles in one's path. But I will say that the most entertaining thing about baby elephants is to watch them learn to use their trunk. That lack of coordination is hilarious. Guys, those of you who experienced our dip in the stream, we do apologize. It's something we're aware of and working on, but we seem to be back up and running once again. And so all is well with the world. And we've got elephants snacking on the weeping wattle tree, making short work of that particular branch. Definitely one of the best mornings. The African bush always provides surprises out here. Not the way I was expecting the day to go, but I'm very happy with it. The little one sleeping now. You're having a rest in the shade of the Pelteforum. Up we get. Oh, shame. Little one, that wasn't a very long nap. Perhaps interrupted by Mom. You've got to be careful where you pick your shade if you're a napping baby elephant. Because there is a chance that the rest of the adults of the herd are going to come and want to munch on your shade tree. Look at what she is doing. She is busy stripping away the bark from the branch itself. Basically like a conveyor belt. It goes in whole and comes out minus bark on the other side. As she twirls it. Oh, there we go. We're getting to the end now. Watch, is she going to eat the leaves as well? Looks like it. The end branches, I think, are going to get completely crunched. So what she's doing there was she was after the cambium layer, but as she gets to the finer branches, there's a bit more in the way of... Nope, she's actually rejected them completely. Right, here we go. Repeat of process. A totally intact branch going in one side of the mouth and slowly being crunched out on the other as her molars strip away the cambium layer. Unfortunately, not within our view, and taking little one with them. Shame. I always feel a bit sorry for the little elephant calves when they walk behind the adults and they get smacked in the face by the branches that the adults don't see as obstacles, but the little ones don't necessarily appreciate. And all the time, our young elephant bull that we pulled up next to, oh, cute little one, has been thinking about coming to give us nonsense. However, he has decided that actually he's a little bit terrified of us and that perhaps it would be more sensible in order to go and catch up with the rest of the herd. And I think this might be our last view of them for now. Not a bad way to spend one's day. I'm going to try a little reposition. We've only got a few short minutes left of the sunrise safari, but let us see if we can't fill those short minutes with elephants on your screen for the last moments. Perhaps we will find a suitable corner to loop around. Let us try. I don't think we're going to be lucky. Oh, yes we are, there's a bottom. There's several bottoms. It's a huge herd of elephants. Oh, there we go. We don't have to. We can look at elephants. Oh, we can look at an elephant with a collar. That looks like a collar sticking up behind her head there. Similar to the one that one. Similar to the one that Sindile wears at this point. There, if you look really closely, you'll see it poking up over the top of her shoulder blades. That is a radio collar that can be used, probably sends out GPS coordinates of her position, or else can be used in terms of radio frequency tracking using telemetry for research purposes mainly. It's questionable whether or not it may well still be active, and will be for one of the various research organizations around here that study these magnificent creatures. There's probably about, I would guess and say, about 70 elephants here. We just can't see most of them because it's a very thick block. But everywhere I turn, another elephant shape ghosts across behind the trees. And they really are the grey ghosts of the African bush. Beautiful girl. Alright guys, we have come to the end of our sunrise safari. I hope you have all enjoyed it as much as I have. A big thank you to Brian, for Brian's 6 weeks of very hard work. We will miss you and we look forward to your return. And a big thank you, the same message applies to Kirsty in Final Control. We will very much miss having your voice in our ears, so thank you for that. Most importantly though, thank you to all of you. And thanks to the thumb as well. By the way, I thought the thumb yesterday was one of the best versions of the thumb ever. Thank you to all of you. I hope you enjoyed it. We will catch up again in a few short hours for the sunset safari. Bye-bye, everybody.
Dave and I are still trying to figure out where this male lion went. There's no tracks of him crossing through to Arethusa or Sibambili, so we're pretty confident he's around here somewhere. So I'm just doing one last little check up towards the gate. But I think this might be a mystery that's going to have to be solved on the sunset safari. As I don't think we're going to have enough time to find the male lion unless we spot him sleeping under a gorry bush in the last few seconds of drive. But how exciting has it been that you have, well, definitely a new leopard for all of the current Safari Live crew. We've never seen Sher 2005 version of Shaluva. Quite strange that she's got two daughters by the same name. Shaluva 2005, Shaluva 2015. But from a Dangerous Dave and myself, or sorry, I forgot, Dangerous Dave the Dish and myself, it's been wonderful having. Thanks for putting up with our vehicle problems, but all sorted, and see you in a few short hours for the sunset safari.